Hello, my Socratica friends. We're here to help you be a great student. In this series, we've been offering you lots of general advice about studying, how to take notes, how to memorize, how to get more out of what you read. Now, we'd like to also offer you some specific advice about how to study certain subjects. Because Socratica focuses on STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, we will start with that most fundamental of the sciences, physics. Believe it or not, if you're a scientist of any kind, you probably want to be studying some physics. It's going to help you understand the underlying behavior of matter, of electricity, of gravity, magnetism, all kinds of fields. Okay, I'm not a physics major. I've read a little. I'm working my way through the Feynman lectures, as you do. But we at Socratica want to make sure you get the best advice from people who really know what they're talking about. So today, we have a guest star. Our friend Simon, who earned his master's in physics at Oxford and just defended his PhD in physics from the University of Exeter. He knows a little bit about the subject. Hi, Simon.
Hello, Socratica. Glad to be here. What time is it in LA?
I have no idea anymore.
So I understand that you want to know more about how to study physics. Well, I actually have a whole YouTube channel dedicated to this idea. And the great thing about it is that physics is one of these subjects that anybody can learn. It doesn't matter what your background is, who you are, where you came from. Anybody can learn physics with the right instruction. It's very democratic.
Oh, I knew you were the right person to talk to.
So, where to start?
How did you get started in physics? Was it your first physics class or?
Okay, so my first experience with physics would have been when I was about 10. I remember we were doing an experiment in primary school where we were rolling toy cars down slopes that were made of different materials. So one was made of carpet, one was made of hard wood, one was made of foam. And we were asked to make a prediction about which car would reach the ground first and which surface. And I remember thinking about the sort of the properties of the materials and sort of weighing up with how gravity was going to pull them down the slope. And I guess it made me realize that there was like a kind of magic quality to physics, that if you understood those rules, if you understood how the world worked, you could make a prediction about something that was going to happen in the future. And so I guess that gave me a glimpse into the real power of physics.
Looking back over your early experience in physics, what technique helped you the most?
So when I started learning physics, a lot of the teaching was done in a very conceptual way. It would be talking about energy, we're going to talk about space. It wasn't anything that you could really kind of bite your teeth into in a quantitative way. So I think that the key thing was when it started becoming quantitative and you started putting maths into the equation, so to speak. And in that case, the most important technique was definitely repeated exercise. So for example, a lot of physics is calculus, basically. Derivatives, integrals, that's something that gets introduced in high school but goes, you know, right the way through to my PhD. And so when learning that, the only way that I was really able to learn that stuff, both in maths classes and in science classes, was to do exercise after exercise after exercise. And I really do think that's the best way to learn quantitative skills, to get the concept in your head, but then to do practice problems. And calculus, I think, was a particular example of that, where you just drill integral after integral after integral until you really understand it.
You've mentioned calculus a few times. What about other math classes?
Well, maths is basically the language of the universe, which means it's the language of physics. You have to understand maths in order to understand physics for any serious level of study. You know, often in problems, you're looking at the rate of change of a variable, or you're summing up a variable over an area, and of course, that's calculus. In other things, like for example, Newtonian mechanics, or what I did my PhD on, which was fluid mechanics on the Earth, vectors are super important. Actually, make that vectors and matrices are important. They're tied up in the field of linear algebra. You know, and that becomes important as you go into higher levels of physics in other fields, as does, for example, group theory. But if you're going to go for a more fundamental aspect of maths, I'd definitely say that algebra is a super important one to understand, because that's the way in which most physical laws are expressed. You know, you have to nail those early maths classes, and I think algebra in particular, to stand much of a chance of really engaging with physics.
What about probability and statistics?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Another really important course, I mean, particularly if you're interested in going into research. I suppose the takeaway is basically you should be taking all of your maths classes seriously. Some people complain that you have to do so much maths in order to do physics, when the fact of the matter is, if you don't like doing maths, you're not going to like doing physics.
That's way harsh, Simon. No, I'm just kidding. We love math here at Socratica. And in an upcoming episode, we'll talk about how to study math. But for now, back to physics.
Physics is basically maths. A physics degree is effectively a maths degree, just with a lot of applications.
Can you remember a particular course you took or a book you read that took your passion for physics and kicked it into high gear?
Yeah, definitely. I think like a lot of people, I remember when I first read something by Richard Feynman. I actually have my copy here. This is Six Easy Pieces. I was given this at a summer school that I went to at Oxford University. And I just remember reading this everywhere. Like, this copy is so battered because I read this when I was hiking in the Pyrenees. I read it in bed, all over the country, on trains. And in particular, there was an excerpt of this. So this is excerpts from his lectures on physics. And part of the lecture that he did on quantum mechanics, where he's talking about the double slit experiment and how the Heisenberg uncertainty relation just kind of falls out of that experiment. I just remember reading that and I kind of wanted to tell everybody I knew about that. I just thought that was so cool. And I think that was when it clicked for me that, like, this is something I'm really passionate about. Like, this is something that I want to study. So, you know, it's one of those books that really kicked what I got out of physics into high gear.
It sounds like you can get a lot out of self-study in physics.
Definitely, yeah.
I remember looking at physics books in a bookstore when I was a kid, and there was The Tao of Physics and not much else. But there are so many books now that are accessible to the layperson.
I mean, I've actually been thinking a lot about the books which I read when getting into physics and then also during my degree and my PhD. And I made this video about which books you should read if you want to study physics, which you can see over on my channel.
Ooh, I'm going to watch that right now.
Oh, great. Thank you.
Well, not right now. We still have to finish our video, Simon.
Yeah, sure. But you will, right?
Absolutely. Love me some Simon Clark videos. Lets me live vicariously through your PhD adventures. Now, I know this is a tall order, but briefly, what are the different areas of physics you can study?
Oof, big question. So there's this video, actually. There's this video called The Map of Physics by Dominic Wallerman. And in it, he breaks down physics into three branches. So I'm gonna crib from him because it's quite a good description. The three branches are classical physics, quantum mechanics, and relativity. So classical physics is basically physics before the 20th century. It's stuff like Newtonian mechanics. If I was to throw a ball up in the air and catch it, that would be well described by classical physics. But what we realized in the 20th century was that if you take that theory to extremes, to really small things or really big things, it kind of breaks down. Its predictions don't match up with the universe. So quantum mechanics is what happens if you zoom in on tiny scales and atoms and subatomic scales, and you have to account for the fact that energy only comes in discrete chunks, in packets, or quanta. That's where we get the name quantum mechanics. That has really, really big implications. And at the other end of the scale, if you blow classical physics up to gigantic scales like a galaxy or the universe, you have to start using relativity, which basically accounts for the fact that you can't go faster than the speed of light. And that distorts classical physics in other ways, which have, again, very big implications.
And out of all of that, how did you pick what you wanted to focus on?
So the way that the physics course at Oxford is structured is for the first 3 years of your degree, you only take maths and physics modules. And in those modules, you do every form of physics. So I did classical mechanics, I did fluid mechanics, I did quantum mechanics, I did special and general relativity, condensed matter physics, optics, electromagnetism, circuits, condensed matter physics. So I was basically exposed to the whole spectrum. And in one course in particular, which was on geophysical fluid dynamics, which is how fluids like air and water move on the surface of a rotating planet like the Earth, That course was like a thunderbolt moment. The idea of describing a continuous system, like a fluid, like water, with a couple of equations, that was so cool. I just knew that I wanted to do that. So in my fourth year, where I could choose my courses, I went for that, and then I followed that through into my PhD. I was basically just following what I thought was cool. But I will say, to be honest, that while I got my core physics knowledge from those classes, the way that I think as a physicist, I think owes more to activities outside of the classroom. So things like going to talks, reading research papers, doing research, and writing my PhD thesis. You know, your education in physics might start in the classroom, but it doesn't end there. It goes out into the rest of the world, and it carries on for the rest of your career.
So let's say we have an idea which area of physics to study. What next?
So if there's a particular area that you're interested in, I think the best thing you can do is to get some first-hand experience with that field. So if you're at university, ask academics if they're after a summer intern or if they have a little research project they'd like doing. It really doesn't have to be much, but you'll get a lot out of just seeing how they work in a research environment. Plus, it also looks great on your CV when you're applying for future research positions and degrees. But what the academic can also do is give you a list of the key research papers in your field. And so that will give you a really detailed grounding in the background of your particular field. That's actually exactly how I got started in my field of stratospheric dynamics when I did a research project on the subject in my third year at Oxford.
What else should our Socratica friends be thinking about if they want to study physics? Are there certain programming languages you would recommend?
I started in C, which is notoriously one of the most hardcore languages, but I wound up using Python for most of my PhD work. And I think if I was to do it all over again, I probably would recommend starting with Python. There is something to be said for starting with a simpler language, and then if you want to learn a second or third or fourth, you can pick up the complexity and draw on your experience and how well you understand a relatively simple one. By this point, I feel like if I wanted to pick up another language, I could do so with how I understand how Python works.
Simon, I have to thank you. I feel like in the last 10 minutes, I've learned a lot from you about how to study physics. What should we do if we want to follow you and your career?
Well, you can follow me on my YouTube channel, which is just my name, Simon Clark. And you can also follow me on Twitter at SimonOxFiz.
Any last words of advice for our Socratic friends who want to be great physics students?
My big takeaway would be that physics is work. You can't just wake up one day and say, I'm going to be great at physics. It doesn't work like that. You've got to put the time in. I know that Kimberly talks about how you have to do about 1,000 problems in any given subject before you know it well enough to recognize all the types of problems that can come up and recognize what tools you need to solve them. And those problem solver books are fantastic for that. Just putting the time in before you level up. And if you do that, then you've really gotten to know the subject. You're genuinely a physics student.
And what you say is true for many subjects.
Absolutely. Yeah, this doesn't just apply to physics. The growth mindset is so key. By watching these videos, you are getting into that mindset that you can be a better student. You're studying how to study. You're investing time in improving yourself. And you're making it more likely that you're going to find the winning strategy for you. So, based on these videos, try some of the techniques. Try the Cornell notes method. Try flashcards with spaced repetition. Try the Feynman technique. That worked great for me.
Thanks for talking with us, Simon.
It was my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Getting advice from subject experts, it's all part of being a great student.
Want to help us make more great videos? Join the Socratica team on Patreon.